being a hostage in a political situation and for political reasons is one thing, but that in all of the people we know, there are people who are being held hostage by so many other things. A terminal illness, for instance, you can't change that. Losing a job, you can't change that. Well, mine was a particular kind of being held. We all in our lives face things that we can't change.
The Iran hostage crisis, patience triumphant over hostility. The hostage crisis was a testament to the international affairs of the United States under Jimmy Carter in the 1970s. While it may have been tragic for the hostages inside the compound and the Americans back home, they triumphed by not giving in to the demands of the Iranian students. Had they done this, they would have promoted actions like these to come. The United States and allies installed Shah Mohammad Reza Pahlavi in Iran in the 1940s because the oil industry in Iran was needed to defeat Nazi Germany in World War II. He was an ally of the West and started modernizing the country. He abused his power and kept the oil fortune. These events were very tragic for the citizens in Iran, forcing them into poverty. Earthquakes made land untillable in 1960, shattering Iran's economy. In response, the Shah created a land reform act to help the impoverished citizens at the expense of large landowners. In 1963, he launched the White Revolution. The revolution was designed to modernize the industry in Iran and did so. Profits from the oil industry rose considerably. The money was used to better education and infrastructure, causing there to be a job shortage going into the late 1960s. The Shah even pushed for women's suffrage. The Ayatollah Ruhollah Khomeini opposed this, protecting the values of Islamists. The Ayatollah was forced to exile the country. He fueled street protests from abroad, which were met by fierce opposition of the Iranian government and army. The Savak secret police force for the Shah were very violent. Many people in the streets were injured and even killed. Pahlavi left Iran for Egypt in early 1979, taking what he called a vacation. The Ayatollah came back from exile during this time. His prime minister went into hiding, allowing Khomeini to seize power of the country and making it an Islamic republic. As a new supreme leader came into power, many Western educated elite fled the country. During this time, the Shah had cancer and was suggested to go to the United States for treatment in New York. Carter was initially opposed to this course of action, but quickly changed his mind after hearing that New York had one of the only facilities that had the potential to save his life.
We're not going to put a man into a rowboat and send him out beyond the continental shelf if he has no place to go. We have said that we are trying to assist him in finding a permanent location.
The Ayatollah pushed for the rallying support of the nation of Iran. He claimed that the United States were willing to pay for the crimes that they were thought to have committed. People were fueled to bring him back and try him for his actions. The protests turned from death to the Shah to death to Carter. Many young people in Iran violently protested the hospitality shown by the U.S. to the Shah, thinking that he came back to negotiate with U.S. government officials to somehow get the Shah or his son back into power. The chanting in the streets was endless and American flags were burned. The United States Embassy in Iran held a lack of security. The Foreign Service members were giving briefings on different situations, but never did they expect an entire embassy compound to be captured. Protesters were often able to get over the gates and fencing surrounding it. Unfortunately, the U.S. Marines stationed at the compound were strictly not allowed to fire on the students no matter what. They were overrun by the hundreds surrounding the compound. Many workers thought that the situation would soon be resolved, but that wasn't the case. More and more, the compound was overrun. Embassy workers eventually accepted the fate and started burning secret documents and notifying Washington of the happenings. Eventually, students forced the workers into custody. The initial number of hostages was 66. They were blindfolded, stripped of their personal items, and searched. They were moved to a location towards the center of the compound.
So long as the authorities in Tehran refused to allow any neutral or outside observers an opportunity to see all prisoners, the possibilities of what may be happening to those prisoners is infinite. It is beyond my capacity to guess and beyond our capacity to know.
The government of Iran must recognize the gravity of the situation which it has itself created, and the grave consequences which will result if harm comes to any of the hostages.
The first move by the U.S. was to freeze Iranian assets in American banks and cut off trade with Iran. The hostages were told to call the male's brothers and the female's sisters. The living conditions were decent, and the food was edible, but the hostages were still miserable. The mail they received, if any, was heavily censored. They were not allowed to see any other hostages. They were stuck with nothing to do but listen to the chants outside. The culture of the Iranians living with them was not one of cleanliness. The Iranian students took upon themselves to make the hostages look like they were being well taken care of. They responded to press conferences and made this claim, but reporters were not allowed to see inside the embassy. The response of the United States was nothing short of amazing. People took after the song, Tie a Yellow Ribbon Around the Old Oak Tree by Tony Orlando. They put yellow ribbons everywhere, symbolizing that they still cared for the hostages. Some even placed an American flag for every day that the embassy workers were held hostage. Only 2 weeks later, on November 19th, Iran militants released 5 women and 8 black men with a gold to show the world that they had respect. 3 others were deemed spies and were therefore kept in captivity, one being Catherine Coop, who lived in Northeast Iowa. The 53 hostages were in it for the long haul. There were some special occasions, including Christmas time. A few priests were allowed to visit the hostages and hold worship services. The students had noticed the hostages praying and gave them Bibles. Jimmy Carter launched Operation Eagle Claw, a secret rescue mission planning on freeing the captives on April 24, 1980. Many air vehicles, including C-130 Hercules transport planes, commandos, and helicopters met on an abandoned airstrip in the Iranian desert called Desert One. Some Iranian vehicles found the stationed Americans. The United States even held an entire tour bus captive and feared that the Iranian government would get word of the mission. Colonel Beckwith canceled the rescue mission and let the people from the bus leave. A chopper kicked up dust, causing vision to lessen. The pilot of the chopper crashed into a grounded transport and both exploded. 8 American lives were lost. All were volunteers. The news of the failed rescue attempt swiftly reached the Iranians. The students moved the hostages to different remote locations, deeming another attempt at a rescue impossible. Word eventually spread to the hostages after a few weeks. It relayed a strong message of hope to the hostages, of whom had not been in high spirits of ever coming back home. On July 11, 1980, Richard Queen was released due to complications with multiple sclerosis. 52 remained. On September 22nd, Iraq declared war against Iran by surprise. Saddam Hussein planned on using the confusion in Iran to take control of the Middle East. The students in control of the hostages claimed that the worse the war was for Iran, the worse the hostages would have it. The plot to get the United States in the war failed. Once again, proof that the U.S. was not going to give in. Meanwhile, the race for the president between Jimmy Carter and Ronald Reagan was in full throttle in the United States. Reagan fueled his campaign on Carter's failure to bring home the captives.
Instead of trying patiently to persuade them to change their ways, we have, in a number of instances, aided a revolutionary overthrow which results in complete totalitarianism instead for those people.
In January of 1981, the United States and Iran went back to negotiating. For the next few weeks, many ideas were discussed, but the one idea settled on was a deal to lift the embargo or trade ban on Iran and release the hostages. The first sign the hostages took they might be going home was the visits of Algerian doctors. They were still skeptical, but they knew what an ally visiting them meant. They had always kept their hopes up, but reality in check. They were blindfolded in cars, still not being able to communicate amongst themselves. They ended up at an airport. The hostages really started getting excited. They were now in the hands of an Algerian airline. The talk and storytelling went on through the entire trip to West Germany. Being officially on American soil meant the world. They had to stay in a hospital for a couple of days for medical work before flying the rest of the way home, but they were able to talk to their families after 444 days in captivity. Meanwhile, Ronald Reagan was being inaugurated into his presidency. Most Americans were far more interested in the returning of the hostages to really care. Many hostages would go on to continue their foreign services and live their life to the fullest. The crisis showed the American government and the governments of other countries that problems can be resolved without military force. Citizens found their voices of support, and diplomats were safe. The triumph of peaceful negotiations set a positive example for resolving the modern issues between two politically conflicted countries. Being held hostage can mean physical captives, such as the Iran hostage crisis. We all experience times of captivity and helplessness in our daily lives. We can challenge ourselves to reach out to those who are hostages to their own individual problems.